Let's take a look at nutrients and their uses in the body. Now, you can think of a nutrient as chemicals being used by the body to produce energy, provide building blocks, or function in other chemical reactions. So that's going to be many, many different things. You can also think of a nutrient as anything that a cell needs. So let's see what these cells need. When you look at these major classes of nutrients, one of them are carbohydrates. When you think of carbs, you think of sugars and the different forms of them. The proteins, and there's lipids, nucleic acids, and water could be put into a group by itself also, since so much of that is needed inside of cells and a certain amount around living cells too. We'll take a little look at vitamins and minerals a little bit further along and their major functions. But going back to nutrients, you often hear about essential and non-essential being used with different things in the body. So when you talk about anything being essential, that means you have to get it in the diet. That means you can't make it yourself. The liver is very good at inner conversion, meaning taking things you have in excess and making some things you may be lacking, but it can't do that with everything. So if you ever hear about something being essential, that means you got to get it in your diet because you can't make it there. So when you look at the 20 different amino acids, 9 are essential. So those you have to consume, 11 of them you don't. And then, of course, there are certain fatty acids, most of your vitamins, your minerals, things you see on the periodic table, most all the water and other materials too. So you look at those non-essential. Again, you don't have to ingest those. You can make those in the body, and again, the liver is where most of that happens. And when you talk about how much energy is in a food material that you eat, that's measured by kilocalories. Often you hear calories being used, but that's probably a mistake in many cases and probably should be kilocalories where you see it. So going back to our carbohydrates here, again, most of these come from plants. One great thing about plants is that they can make their own energy. Give them water and sunlight and a place to grow, they can make sugar. And besides all that coming from plants, only other place you're going to find it is the lactose coming from milk. Now look at the different classes of carbs. Look at your little prefixes, mono, di, and polysaccharides. Everybody knows mono is one. Here's where I got just one simple sugar, no other bound to it. When you look at examples, glucose is one we've mentioned before. That's the form of the sugar the cells need along with oxygen to go through aerobic respiration and make energy. You get all these disaccharides, and here's where you got two simple sugars combined. Sucrose, maltose, and lactose are examples there. Polysaccharides, where you got three or more. Starch, glycogen we've mentioned, big energy storage molecule, a lot of that stored up in the liver, some in skeletal muscle. And then cellulose, which we can't digest. But the body's gonna take these di and polysaccharides, break them down and convert them to glucose in the liver. You need to constantly feed that to the cells for that energy production. When you talk about uses of carbohydrates in the body, again, you got to break them down, let the liver convert those monosaccharides into glucose. Again, give that to the cell along with oxygen. That aerobic respiration is how almost all ATP will be made. When you have excess glucose, you consume more of it, what you need at the moment. You can store that up in the form of glycogen. Again, liver's going to store up a lot of that for you, muscles a bit too. And then beyond that, you'll store the excess up in your adipocytes in the form of fats. Sugars are also big, important parts of things like DNA. You look at DNA and look at those vertical strands running up and down. So you see the cytosine, guanine, adenine, thymine in the middle. But with those vertical strands, those are alternating simple sugars and phosphates. You couldn't make a DNA molecule without them. Same goes for RNA, ATP, and other examples in the body too. Looking back at the lipids or fats, most of them exist in the body in the form of triglycerides. There is more energy in 1 gram of lipids than any other molecule in the body. So that's a great energy storage molecule there. You sometimes hear about the saturated and unsaturated. Those that are saturated examples are meat fats, whole milk, cheese, and eggs. Very good stuff right there. And then the unsaturated, things like olive and peanut oil. Cholesterol you hear about quite a bit. A lot of that's found in the liver there. Egg yolks, right? It's another place you can find it, but not in plants. Phospholipids. Remember, if you look at the cell membrane and every cell in the body, almost half of it is made up of a phospholipid. So that's a very big, important part of all those cell membranes. And then there's linoleic acid, which has some fatty acids in them, which are also essential. Looking at uses of lipids, again, the triglycerides are used to produce energy in the form of ATP there. The excess is stored up in the fat cells in the liver. It's where almost all energy is stored, in those areas right there. You got that cholesterol, a component of plasma membranes, and can be modified to form other materials like steroids in the body. You have the adiponocytes, derived from fatty acids, are involved with inflammation, blood clotting, tissue repair, and smooth muscle contraction. And then there's phospholipids, again, part of the plasma membrane. And also think about other good examples like the myelin sheath. Remember, that's that electric insulating layer of fat you find around nerves and axons. We look at our proteins. Remember that all proteins are an assembly of amino acids. There's 20 of them total. 9 essential, so again, you have to get those in the diet. 11 being non-essential, which you don't need to get in the diet because the liver can make them for you. And when you hear about a complete protein, that's going to be a protein that has every one of those essential amino acids in it. So stuff like meat, fish, poultry, milk, cheese, and eggs have every one of those. Those are materials you've got to consume. And the functions of proteins is almost endless. There are a few examples listed here, like antibodies. Now think about those made by the B plasma cells. How would you fight off foreign materials and such that come inside of you that would do damage without those proteins? Enzymes. Remember, those are proteins that lower activation energy and also speed up chemical reactions. Some of our hormones are definitely proteins. Look at collagen, the most abundant protein in the body. Provides strength to a lot of tissues, especially a lot of connective tissues. Look at muscle. You see the actin and myosin. Those are very abundant proteins there. Other things like hemoglobin in red blood cells and ion channels you see in cell membranes. Those are all big examples of proteins that we've looked at before. When you talk about the recommended amounts of this material, that would actually vary greatly depending on the individual, depending on their age, their gender, their activity, and other things such as that. But in general, somewhere around 60% carbs, 30% lipids, and 10% proteins would get most people by. But again, you really have to look at the individual themselves.